approximately 17% of the Earth's terrestrial area is classified as arid, and 1/10 of that area can be attributed to the deserts of North America. The main determinant of arid climates in western North America is the presence of local mountain ranges, creating rain shadows in the Great Basin and Mojave Deserts, the Sonoran Desert, and the Chihuahuan. What makes this biome unique is that most of the world's arid deserts are created by predictable descending high pressure systems at subtropical latitudes, also called Hadley cells. However, the Chihuahua and Sonoran deserts are influenced by the high pressure cells, therefore making it different from any other biome in the world. The climate of these biomes can be shown as one moves west to east, the Mojave to Chihuahuan, the ratio of winter to summer and rainfall decreases. The Mojave Desert and the Great Basin Desert receive primarily winter rainfall in the spring growing season. The majority of the Sonoran Desert has a bimodal rainfall regime, spring and summer growing seasons. Chihuahuan Desert receives summer rainfall. Although other factors are certainly involved, these differences in seasonal rainfalls are sufficient to the effect of differences in vegetation structure and floristic composition. In more simple terms, the four primary deserts of North America are the cold desert shrub and the shrub steppe, the Great Basin, and the warm deserts of the Mojave, the Sonoran, and the According to Britannica Encyclopedia, in arid regions, average annual precipitation ranges from near 0 to 150 millimeters per year, and potential evapotranspiration, PET, ranges from 2,000 to 4,000 millimeters per year. The way these deserts get their water is in regions with arid climates, most of the water is gained from precipitation and is quickly lost through evaporation. An important difference between warm and cool deserts is that deep drainage rarely occurs on vegetated sites in the warm deserts, whereas it is common in cool deserts. This helps explain finding the deeper rooted desert perennials may not utilize summer rains because they do not result in long-term soil moisture storage. As one descends in elevation in desert regions, rainfall not only decreases, but variability in rainfall increases. In extremely wet seasons, significant amounts of total moisture is stored in the soil, and in extremely hot regions, rainfall not only decreases, but variability in rainfall increases. North American deserts have many varieties of insects, including grasshoppers that occasionally reach destructive proportions. Lizards, snakes, and other reptiles, the most conspicuous animals, are dependent on plant fluids or devoured animals for moisture. Likewise, desert birds are largely independent of water sources, as they derive their moisture from insects and spiders from which they eat. Rodents, including mice, rabbits, and squirrels, rabbits, and bats, are the most numerous mammals, essentially nocturnal. They remain underground during the heat of the day and, like birds and reptiles, obtain moisture from their food, higher up in the food chain, in which carnivores, as coyotes, bobcats, foxes, and skunks, and the largest desert mammal, found at higher elevations, is a bighorn sheep. Here I have constructed you an example of a North American desert food web, which starts with your producers, your plants, your yucca, and your prickly pear cactus. From then on, there's also your decomposers, insects, fungi, and bacteria, which consists of grasshoppers, beetles, bacteria, and fungi. Now, from then on, your prickly pear will be eaten by your jackrabbit, your desert tortoise, and your kangaroo rat. Now, your yucca will be eaten by your jackrabbit and your desert tortoise. Then on, your grasshopper will be eaten by your consumers, your animals, your rattlesnake, jackrabbit, and kangaroo rat, in which your grasshopper will be consumed by a rattlesnake and a kangaroo rat. Your beetle will also be consumed by the kangaroo rat, and the scorpion will be consuming the grasshopper. From then on, the kangaroo rat is then eaten by the rattlesnake, and so is the jackrabbit. Then you go to your carnivores, your kit fox and your red-tailed hawk, in which the kangaroo rat is eaten by your kit fox, and your jackrabbit is eaten by your kit fox, your rattlesnake, and your red-tailed hawk. Energy in an ecosystem always flows from the sun to the producers, plants, and consumers, and eventually to the decomposers, which return the energy to the soil. For example, when a kangaroo rat eats seeds, energy is stored in the seeds to flow to the rat. When a hawk eats the rat, energy flows from the rat to the hawk. When the hawk dies, the energy is left in the waste, and dead hawk flows to the decomposers. The decomposers play an important role in nutrient cycles. Decomposers, like fungi, bacteria, return energies and nutrients to the soil, water, or air, where they can be used again by the plants. In every step of the energy flow, there is always some loss of energy in the form of heat. A hypothesis I predicted is that if the rattlesnake or the desert tortoise dies, nothing or no impact would ever be made, because the tortoise only functions from the plants and has no impact on the rest of the animals. None of the consumers eat the desert tortoise other than the tortoise eating the prickly pear cactus and the yucca plant. Say the scorpion has eaten many of the beetles and grasshoppers and an increase in the scorpion population has occurred. Well, that would be a major impact on the rest of the food web, as they will eat the rest of the beetles and the grasshoppers, which are prevalent in rattlesnakes and kangaroo rats and many different organisms in the desert system. Keystone species are shown to be prevalent within this biome, as without the keystone species, new plants or animals would also come into the habitat and push out the native species. Some species of hummingbirds are keystone species to all of the deserts in North America. Hummingbirds pollinate many varieties of native cactus and other lands. An area of the Sonoran Desert with few hummingbirds, invasive species such as buffalo grass have taken over the ecosystem. The area may be too hot or too cold during the part of the year. Most birds that breed in the north cannot withstand the cold of the winter, so they move south for warmer weather. For example, grassland sparrows move south from the Great Plains to the desert grasslands because snow covers their northern homes. Rough-legged hawks and merlin abandon their homes in the winter. In contrast, some animals cannot endure the heat of the summer, and they escape by migrating in handfuls of miles of a valley and into the mountains. Mule deer in the American Southwest seasonally complete this cycle between mountain and desert, as do juncos, white-crowned sparrows, and goshawks. Desert tortoise was placed on both the California and Federal Endangered Species list in 1989 and 1990, respectively. Its status is threatened, just one notch below endangered. Several factors conspire to diminish the population of the desert tortoise. As more people moved into the western deserts, the resultant loss of the habitat made a serious dent in the number of tortoises. With more people came more ravens, large blackbirds, and a keen appetite for hatchling tortoises. The number of ravens has exploded in recent years due to in large part of their ability to thrive in developed areas.
It is honestly hard to imagine that global warming could have much an effect on the world's already hot deserts. But even small changes in temperatures or precipitation could drastically impact plants and animals living in the desert. In some cases, global warming is predicted to increase area of deserts, which is already a quarter of the earth. Human activities such as firewood gathering and the grazing of animals are also converting semi-arid regions into deserts, a process known as desertification. Population growth and greater demand for land are serious obstacles in the effort to combat this problem.
Years of drought and rising temperatures influenced by climate change are now posing new threats for desert animals in the Southwest, compounding the cultures on species already decimated by decades of expanding development and destruction of habitat. For desert tortoises, the prolonged drought has withered much of the vegetation on which they depended. But one cool morning this spring, tortoises emerged from their burrows on a rocky hillside beneath an airway of windmills to feed on clumps of grass and rare desert dandelions. Despite the drought, desert tortoises that survive are taking advantage of this bloom, said Mickey Aga, a researcher studying tortoises at the Mesa Wind Farm. He pointed out that one tortoise had green juice on its mouth from the plants it had eaten, and he said that it was a good sign. Although many solutions won't last forever, as scientists predict that those trends will intensify as global average temperatures climb in response to rising levels of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. Some animals could become extinct, while others are likely to be driven into smaller pockets. As we look at what we expected, it's overwhelming, said Philip Unit, an ornithologist and curator of the Department of Birds and Mammals at San Diego. Life is going to be difficult for all organisms, and surely there will be some capitalizing on it. Just as we have seen with fires, there are species that can capitalize on that, but even those species that capitalize on that, there's a limit, so we're looking around for limits in the face.